In the previous video, we have talked about primary databases. Now we are moving on to the secondary databases. Secondary databases are actually derived from primary databases. Data in the primary databases can be processed either manually or using computers to derive the secondary databases. Secondary databases get its information either from other primary or secondary databases or controlled vocabularies or scientific literature. So data from the primary databases can be used to generate the data in the secondary databases. So when compared to the primary databases, secondary databases is having low redundancy. That is, the repetition of data is less in the secondary databases. And most of the secondary databases are highly curated. Mostly the manual curation is there. So the authenticity of data is also high. Then we use complex combination of computational and manual algorithm for the curation of the data. And the sophisticated techniques and softwares are used to make new knowledge. Knowledge creation can be done using this secondary databases. Which is very much important for predicting the functions of a novel protein. In the most cases, secondary databases also give us tools for investigating the properties of the protein. So it is, when compared to the primary databases, secondary databases are more advanced. But all of the secondary databases are based on the data from the primary databases. Secondary databases work by analyzing the pre-existing data and information about the structure and the function. Most of the secondary databases will have most of the annotations regarding the structure and the function of the functional characteristic of the sequence and structures. If I give an example, if you have a protein structure, the secondary databases used to have tools to find which enzymatic activity it is possibly have, or what will be the active site of this enzyme, and to which metals it is going to bind, or which part of the DNA it can bind. So secondary databases has tools for that, and do also have automatic tools or the computerized tools to analyzing the protein for novel function. And many secondary databases are applied to the protein sequences rather than nucleotide sequences. So the primary databases, most of them are actually for the nucleotides, but in secondary databases, most of them are dealing with the proteins. And one example for the secondary databases is TR-EMBL. TR-EMBL actually stands for translated EMBL. EMBL is a nucleotide databases. So what here is we are doing is like the computer is actually translating the nucleotide sequence in the EMBL into protein sequence. We know the codon usage, so based on the codon we can translate it into the nucleic acid sequence. So that's why it's called a translated EMBL. It is computerly analyzing the records, and it also have a mechanism for annotate the data automatically. But the proteins produced in the TR-EMBL is hypothetical in nature. It may not be the real protein, it is a hypothetical protein, and it actually complements the SwissPort of the Uniport. So this is a comparison between the primary database and the secondary database. Then there is something called the hybrid database. They are the combination of both the primary and the secondary database. It will have option for submitting the real experimental work, and based on this real experimental work, it will generate annotations and predictions. So that are called hybrid databases. And many of the composite protein sequence databases are the example of these hybrid databases, which include UniProt and PIR. If you take the example of the UniProt accepts the primary sequences. You can actually submit the primary protein information in the UniProt, but also make peptide sequence from the genome sequences. If you submit a nucleotide sequence, it will automatically generate the peptide sequence corresponding to that particular genomic sequence. So it's basically a primary as well as a secondary databases. So that's why we call it as a hybrid database. So UniProt stands for Universal Protein Resources. It is a comprehensive resource for protein sequence and annotation of data. UniProt is maintained by UniProt Consortium. It is freely accessible for protein sequence and protein function. UniProt is having four different core databases, which include UniProt KB, which includes SysPort and TR-EMBL, then UniProt Track and UniRefer. The most important one among this one is UniProt KB. KB stands for Knowledge Base. It's a central database which is actually collect the functional information of protein and with annotations. It has two different brands, UniProt KB SwissProt, which is a manually annotated records. It's actually a primary database. Then UniProt KB TRMBA, which is actually computationally generated secondary database. 95% of these entries in the UniProt KB are originated from the machine translation, which is secondary in nature. UniProt Reference Cluster is abbreviated UniRef, which is another database in the UniProt. It clusters the data and it's actually less redundant than the UniProt KB. The UniProt KB, as it is a primary database, or the translated database, it is having high level of redundancy, which is avoided in the UniProt Reference Cluster or UniRef. And it also merges the similar sequence fragments are merged to a single sequence. UniProt Archive is named as UniProt. UniProt is a comprehensive non-redundant database. The non-redundancy in UniProt is actually due to the technology or the mechanism of giving a stable unique identifier or UPI to each of the databases. And UniProt also track the changes in the source database, so it's actually a meta database. It will get sequence from different small databases. Then the protein information resource is another hybrid database. It integrates public informatics bioinformatic resources. It's the largest and the most comprehensive annotated protein sequence database in the public domain. It supports genomic, proteomic and system biology research and studies. It maintains the protein sequence database or PSD. So PSD is a part of PIR. It is established in 1984 by NBRF. PIR has so much resources. I will just go through it. One is IPTMMET, which is actually for studying the post-translation modifications. Then iProlink. iProlink is resource to assess test mining tools. Then it has Pro. Pro provides ontological representation of protein in related entries. PRISP provides comprehensive and non-overlapping clustering sequence to reflect evolution relationship. Then one of the major tools in the PIR is iProClass. It is a database. This database provides value-added information so about UniProt, data in the UniProt. So it's actually a method of finding novel functions of a protein. It helps us to characterize and find new functions of already discovered proteins. So it's an easy, sophisticated way of finding novel functions or novel domains of the protein. And PIR also has different type of search mechanism, which include test search, just like we are searching in Google, or we can go for batch retrieval, like multiple data can be retrieved in the same time, or peptide match, we can search the peptide based on the sequence. If you enter the sequence, you will get similar sequences out of it. And we can do sequence alignments like global and local alignments can be done. Then ID mapping is to see the correspondence of IDs based on the IDs of different proteins. And we can actually retrieve molecular weight and composition of each proteins from this PIR. There are some databases are called specialized databases. They cater to the particular research interest. It may be for a specific organism, just like the FlyBase. FlyBase is a database only for the Drosophila melanogaster. Sequence information from the Drosophila melanogaster will be put in the FlyBase. Or rat genome database is only for rats. WormBase is only for the C. elegans. Then sequence category or function, we can have databases like gene disease database. Only genes which is related to some diseases will be placed there. Or SNPedia is for SNPs. Then molecular interaction has specific databases like BioGrid or RNA binding protein database. So these are all for special purposes. So these are the different types of databases. So in summary, databases are divided into primary, secondary and specialized databases. Before moving on to the more topics, I would like to introduce the FASTA format. FASTA format is not very much related to the databases, but most of these databases are using FASTA format for representing the genomic sequences. So I think it will be better to understand what is a FASTA format. FASTA format is a text-based format for representing nucleic acid and amino acid sequences. It is a very simple format. It is using single letter code for protein and amino acids. The sequence names are and comments. There are a region for identifying which sequence it is, and there is a like which is followed by the DNA or protein sequence. It is FASTA format is actually first originated for in the FASTA software, but now it is universally used in all type of bioinformatics applications. And there is no standard extension for FASTA format. People use different format, and in our computer we can use the text file or the Word file to create the FASTA format. And how to create this FASTA format? As I said before, it is a very simple format. It is a text-based format, but it always begins with a right-angled bracket. Here you can see, okay, which is followed by the name and a description of the sequence. You can give any names, and after this description, we go for an enter, which is called a hard return. Then the sequence will be sequence of the protein or the DNA will be entered in a sequential manner, and there is no space or return between the sequences. So NCBI is actually having a SwiftKID which actually help us to write this header, okay, which organism it is originated from, which part of the gene, who found this gene, things like that can be given in this header region. Other than that, the format is very much similar. So this is an example of the FASTA format. To start with this bracket and then the description. After the description, we will just write the sequence of the protein or the nucleic acid. So this is a single letter codon representing the amino acids. So that's all for this session. Thank you so much.